I'm Maria Menounos, and you're tuned in to AfterBuzz TV, the ESPN of TV talk. Now, let the buzz begin.
Hey, everybody.
Hey, everybody.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to AfterBuzz TV, the ESPN of TV talk. And we are here for a new show on HBO called Betty, episodes 1 and 2. I'm here with my amazing co-host, Miss Kittie. Miss Kittie, how are you doing today?
I'm wonderful, Courtez. It's good to meet you. And I'm so glad that we're on this show together because it's unpacking a lot of things that, I think will make for great conversation.
I agree. There's a lot of underlying meaning, I will say. And they're very subtle within. So I don't want to waste any time. We can go ahead and talk about it. We're going to cover episodes 1 and 2. So we can kind of briefly touch on 1 and then we'll move into 2. So just as an overall thought, what were your initial thoughts, Miss Kitty?
Well, I have to
Do you mind if I call you Miss Kitty? I'm sorry.
I have no problems with that, darling. Okay. And thank you for asking because a lot of people call me Miss Kitty. And I'm like, why do you got to put a miss on the front? But it's fine. I don't have a problem with it at all. I enjoyed the show. First of all, my overall thoughts were that I enjoyed it a lot. But I watched the trailer and I was convinced that I would like it. Like, I knew it was going to be pretty dope in terms of like the way my brain works. I knew that I would find it relatable in that I never skated. I'm not going to profess to know how to skate, but I often found myself in male dominated genres or situations. And I just liked that I was always enough of myself that I didn't get allow men or boys to kind of overshadow me just being a regular. You know what I mean? I like that I put myself in situations where I was wanted to be thought of as an equal. And so it really appealed to me what they did with the show and how they projected that image. And I love all the characters. It's funny because I can tell that they're not like trained actors, but the one that stands out the most to me as being not an actor is the one I like the most, actually, Kirt. Is my favorite character, without question.
Kurt is very interesting.
yes.
Her character is very laid back. And she also had, I know they're in New York, but she also has a Cali swag about her that Like, I think she could be from both. Maybe she's from there. I don't really know what it is, but I enjoy Kurt. As an overall thought, this show, it caught my attention because for one, I love seeing rebellious kids doing grown things, like shows like that. I love seeing kids do things that they should be doing. And I'm not saying they should be skating, but they're obviously, you know, they're smoking and doing all these things that they probably shouldn't be doing. So initially I was like, okay, this stuff is gonna be good, like bad kids, why not? So here we are. And honestly, when I watched it, I was like, this is more than just kids or, you know, a teenager's doing more than that. It was a lot more to it. So I'm excited to talk about it. And I guess, as you mentioned, you started with the characters, you said Kurt. So what else about Kurt do you think made her your favorite compared to the others?
There was a part there where I believe it's in the second episode and she's, well, comparatively to the others, she stands out because she's the ringleader. In her mind, at least. But she's not extremely articulate. She's not, I'm not gonna say she's dumb by any means, but she's not like the sharpest knife in the drawer, in my opinion.
Correct.
So all of these things seem to be things that could be used against her, when in fact, she's the one that's rallying everybody together. She clearly has, like, I don't wanna say a pure heart, that's a bit much, but she's a good heart. She really does enjoy inclusiveness. She wants everybody to just hang out. She's like, we're girls, we can do this by ourselves. Look, I brought drinks. Like, she wants very much for them to all just kind of have a camaraderie. And even though it's not, it doesn't seem to be organic, she's like going to make it organic, which obviously is the opposite of what that word means. But she's like, you know, we're girls, we like to skate. Even if you have a small interest, let's get together and like make this a thing. But there was one scene that bothered me a little bit. And I'll tell you why. Clearly, she has grown up in an environment with Black folk. That much is evident. So when she was introducing the one girl, she's yelling across the skate park to the young lady. Just said her name.
You're talking, Honeybear.
What's her name? No. The Honeybear is the one with the mohawk.
Yes, Honeybear's mohawk.
Okay, my bad. So when she was screaming across the skate park to Honeybear about the young lady she was standing with, like, she likes you too. Like, she has no social cues. Obviously, nobody wants to be called out on having a crush on someone, and then that's the way you make the introduction. She didn't even ask you to make an intro. Like, how about just relax? So she does the most, but I thought it was so cute when Honeybear skated away and was like, I don't know what you're talking about. She looks at the girl and goes, she just shy. She's shy. And I was like, okay, clearly that's your interpretation of how Black people talk. So a part of me was a little, that kind of rubbed me the wrong way. But at the end of the day, I don't think she's doing anything malicious. I don't think she's mimicking the way that she thinks that Black people speak in an attempt to like assimilate. I think it's just what she's comfortable with. And this is who she's chosen, or her friends have chosen her either way. And so that's kind of the world that she's ended up in. I just have a problem with different ethnicities that try to, I guess they call that appropriation, right? Where they try to mimic or become who they hang out with or their environment in an attempt to show like, I'm down, look at me, I'm cool. Yeah. You know, I moved to India and now I know how to tie an Indian sari. So doesn't that make me a cool Indian? Like, girl, no. So, you know what I mean? So I think a part of that I didn't like.
So in that, I can understand where you're coming from. I think that just in where she is, I think she's just been absorbed in that. She seems to be like she's not from your average, you know, neighborhood or even that. So I think that goes along with her character. And then let's talk about another character, Janay, who is, she seems to be like her, the yin and yang. They're like the two girls. They're like the besties, it seems like. They're the foundation. And they're very close.
The ones that started this together,
exactly. And so initially I would have said that that was my favorite character, but my favorite character is actually Indigo, who is your favorite character's interest or whatever she wants to be. So Indigo, if we talk about her quickly, she is new to the skate world. She was obviously just minding her business. She's a very chill girl, and she's brought into this skate life in the first episode where she's just on a skateboard. But obviously she's brought in because, what's her name? Because Kirt is attracted to her. So Kirt is obviously, she's a lesbian. And that seems to be the same for Honeybear, which we found out more. I didn't learn until the second episode. So these girls, you know, in the society that they're in, not only are they trying to, you know, make room within this, you know, highly dominated male realm of skating, but they're also, you know, they're just not your average girls. You know, they're not your average girls.
Exactly. Not at all. Not at, they they're stand not, out in so many different ways. And, each and of them individually.
Correct. Sorry. Correct. I would definitely agree. And so okay, let's talk about before we move to episode two. What the big thing about episode one was the chase for the backpack. Right. Okay, so they met this girl. We haven't talked about Camille yet, but Camille is the girl that they met. They thought that she saw the flyer, and they thought that she was coming to their, I guess, posted event, but she really was just randomly there, and or she was one of the girls that were randomly there, and she had this backpack which she lost that had the key in it to get into this skate park. They wanted to get into this skate park that was, I guess, mainly with where men were basically skating. What were your thoughts on the backpack search and then how Camille ended up getting into the skate park and leaving other girls behind? Because that brings us to episode two.
I'm so glad you asked. Yes.
Okay.
So first of all, Camille didn't seem like she was too interested in necessarily having a solidarity moment with these young ladies. Mm-hmm. When they came up upon her physically and asked her, like, do you want to be down? She was just like, I mean, I guess. It looked like the expression that she had and the way she responded was more like, look, I'm going to skate either way, whether y'all are here or not. Like, this has already been my thing, joining your group. I mean, I guess maybe we'll see. It wasn't like, it definitely wasn't definitive. But now that we know Camille, we know that nothing about Miss King is definitive. She has no loyalty, and she's a crab ass bitch. Sorry. Not a crab ass B. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to use the word B. But she is a crab ass. There's no question
She's looking out for herself.
Herself. Because, right. And in the backpack, just to answer your question, it wasn't just the keys to the park. Literally, like, her wallet, her phone. Yeah. The other guy's keys.
The other guy's like stuff, too.
Right. So it was a big
deal. That's what they were really wanting to find it for. It was for, they were probably upset about the phone and the keys, but they wanted, if she didn't find that backpack, she knew that she would never get into that male skate club.
Well, and yeah, but the fact that they were showing that they could be good friends. They don't know this girl from a hole in the wall, but they're literally chasing down with using their own phones to find this for her. It couldn't have been just one person, just Janay. No, just Janay, you're right. And the other one stayed back in the park. But guess what? Mm-hmm. The photographer decided to continue to unravel. And I don't like that they didn't give her her props. Nobody looked at her and was like, because of you, we found the bag. And I didn't like that. I wish that they would have given her roses while she was still here, because she deserved them.
Honeybear?
She deserved, because she did the research. She looked through the pictures and was able to determine that this is where it went. They wouldn't have known that. The guy had it hidden when they came up upon him. So it wasn't like, you know, he was advertising, oh, by the way, I stole your backpack. Without her having done the research in her own pictures, I don't believe that they would have found it. Mm-hmm. And instead of her saying thank you and being so, so grateful and holding them down when they all went to that little spot or whatever with the skaters, she decided to be like, I don't know, you, thanks, I guess, maybe, give me that backpack and let me keep it moving. I really, as a woman that truly believes in the solidarity of women and how we should have each other's back, that really rubbed me the wrong way. Like, girl, you ain't too young to know.
It was messed up.
It was real messed up. Like, I kept trying to give her some excuse, like, well, she's young and she, nah, bruh. You know the difference between being a good person and a bad person. And clearly you're not the best kind of person.
So I agree. I thought I would like her, but then, like I said, I was just like, oh, man, like, it's kind of messed up. But at the same time, you know, she kind of showed her true colors from the beginning, that she was like, you know, when she showed who she was. They were very nice. And obviously, I think it was more so I think the thing that was blinding them all was this key. They wanted to keep the skate park.
Yeah.
They were Honeybear and the rest of them were unable to see who she truly was. And honestly, she didn't really care. She just wanted to find it because she knew that if she didn't, she would not be able to hang with these guys that she wanted to.
Because that's who she really wants to be down with.
Exactly.
Whereas so the other girls, that's not their agenda. Right? They just want to be inclusive. They just want to be able to skate with no problems. They don't want guys ogling them and talking stupid to them. And they want that solidarity of having they've given themselves a name to kind of substantiate their place there. But homegirl has all kinds of other alternative motives. You're right. And I don't like it. She want to be up under the boy. She want that one boy to like her. I don't like that girl.
So moving into episode 2, because that's, you know, it picks up again in episode 2, and we see Honeybear. Honeybear is home, and you see her father, and I think her mother or grandmother. I wasn't sure who she was to her, but you see her, and she's just, it's kind of, the one thing I want to say before we talk about anything else, the camera motion and action within this is very, it's almost like even if you're watching just the non-skating parts, you're just skating. Everything is moving. And have you noticed that within the cinematography of it?
Yeah, I think it's one of the, it's not handheld. What is it called? Oh my God, I'm so mad. You wear it literally on your body. A body cam.
Yes.
No, it's not body cam. But it's like that, where the camera is literally attached to you. It's very interesting. I love that camera.
Because it's like I'm moving.
POV. It's POV. Mm-hmm. It's definitely point of view. And it's a great way to show that. And yeah, I love Honey Bear's family. I think that's probably her grandma. That's her grandma.
I think it was too.
Yeah, that was a nice moment.
So she moves on, and then they go into the park with She goes with Kirk and the other crew. It's so many names. I know them.
Yeah.
Back and forth. Right. They go to the park, and I believe they see Camille, who is over there, and obviously Kirk, you know, she's like, you know, seeing Camille, and Camille is underneath. She's obviously with the guys that she went to the park with.
Right.
And now you see more of Camille, like you mentioned, she's with this guy, and it seems like she wants to do more than skate. Like she's trying to, everything she can to impress the guys.
This guy,
she's all the guys, really, like all of them.
All of them all together, but she definitely likes that one guy, and she clearly wants attention from him. You're absolutely right. I'm surprised they didn't jump her. Like, I would have been, I'm sorry, I'm not advocating violence. Clearly, I'm an adult, so I'm not fighting no children. But at that age and time in my life, if I would have done, they literally spent the entire day holding you down, only for you to give them your ass to kiss? That was not very cute, homie. Matter of fact, I can show you better than I can tell you. I'm just telling you my mentality at that age.
They could have got it.
I would have, it on sight. You hear me? Because she's not a good friend at all. I didn't like that. Oh, yeah, I was very disappointed. So yeah, the Camille girl is the worst to me. Kirt is definitely my favorite. Which one is Indigo again? Oh, the one with the hair and she's freewheeling and she's right. The thin one.
Right, freewheeling. She's learning how to skate. So that's why they're at the park because they're.
That's right.
It's her first time at the skate park. And she actually gets discovered by, right. And they're like, I thought they were going to be a little more hateful. They're going to be like kind of more jealous and envious, but they really weren't. You know, they were just kind
they're
of like,
girls.
They're the good girls. But Indigo stood out to me because Indigo was just like, they're like, are you going to take it? You going to do it? She was like, no. And I don't think she's actually going to do it. I think, you know, it's cool, but this is not really her realm. Like right. She says later on, she thought skating was zen. And it's a lot more to it. And I think she is like the opposite of everybody. Like this whole skating thing is just like, it's not beneath her, but it's not her focus.
Mm.
It's not her. She's enjoying the moment, but mm-hmm. where they wanted to take them, she really doesn't care. Like, that's just so evident that most times people, when they're discovered in this industry, like they're not even really trying. Like people like that don't really see the potential in themselves. They just kind of get pooped, you know? And that's what happened to her. So what do you think about Indigo?
I think that Indigo is very free-spirited. I mean, obviously, mm-hmm. she has blonde eyebrows, for God's sake. Like, clearly, she stands out because she likes to be thought of as eclectic or different. Mm-hmm. And all of that's dope. Like, who wants to fit in, right? Like, I love that about her. And I like mm-hmm. that she's very independent. She doesn't seem like she's allowing anybody to push her in one way or another. Mm-hmm. And she's probably the most girly girl out of all of them, would you say? Because when she first got on the skate, she was just like, oh, and I don't know, and we, you know, and I like that about her as well. She's not perpetrating a fraud. She's not trying to fit into a group or not a group for any other reason. Mm-hmm. And the fact that she didn't follow up with the lady, I mean, maybe she will. You're right. She did get the card.
It will,
Yeah, but initially, it wasn't that she was turned off by the offer, and she was flattered. I think it was more like, just as you said, this is not like my wheelhouse. This is not what I do. Mm-hmm. So I'm not about to lie to kick it. I don't need to tell this woman, oh, yeah, I've been skating 10 years so I can be down with the cool kids. I'm mm-hmm. cool. You know what I mean? Like, I will, whatever I decide to do, I'm going to be cool with it. I just get the impression.
She just want
to
smoke. She just want to smoke and chill.
And just enjoy her life. Like, she just want to be out and about. And all that tying me into one specific group of people, I don't know about all that. Mm-hmm. And just as you said, mm-hmm. homegirl, of course, Kirt made it sound like this was about to be like some, you know, smoke a blunt and then just fly through the air on a skateboard. She's like, I keep falling and there's boys ogling me. This is not zen. Okay? I don't need confrontation. You trying to fight boys. Girl, bye. Like, this is not my steez. I just want to enjoy my life. And I get that. I like that about her.
I agree. You mentioned that fight. Like, that was very interesting, you know, because she was all, you know, Kirt, obviously, I didn't expect anything different from her. She's definitely a powerhouse. She made it very clear that she will get right with the guys as the guys would. And what the guy was like, you lucky you a girl. I'm not going to hit you. I was like, oh, God. I was glad he didn't hit her. I was like, please don't hit her.
Right, because that is not okay. But she definitely pushed it. She knew that she could get away with physically pushing this boy and nothing happening. And that's probably why she had that fight and all in her, too. I mean,
and I didn't like that.
That wolf. Yeah, because you wolfing. You know, goddamn what, this boy punch you in your face. You looking real crazy about it. He's still a boy. Like, let's call it what it is. I cannot fight a grown man and expect to come out unscathed. He's still a boy.
Exactly.
So,
I think she made herself look more, because I think she was trying to defend Indigo.
Indigo. But she likes made herself. Her. You know,
she does like her.
So she's trying Indigo, to make an impression.
She is trying to make an impression. Do you think Indigo likes her? Do you think she? I think she just she's like, la, la, la.
She doesn't care. Right. She's just like, whatever, dude. I don't think that she likes anybody. I think she really likes herself, which is dope. Yeah. Self-love.
I agree.
And I think that she promotes that kind of energy. She doesn't have an inkling or a loyalty mm-hmm. or a division. I just don't get the impression that, you know, she could take it or leave it pretty much in anything. I get the impression, mm-hmm. like, if they go get pizza and they, you know, all out of the popular pizza that everybody wants, she'll just be like, it's got pineapples. Something new. Give me that one. She doesn't, you know, she's just not invested in anything except herself, which is mm-hmm. awesome. That's about as badass as you could possibly get, in my opinion, because you're mm-hmm. not following the fray. You're not saying, I'm associated with this group or the other. She comes through, she skates, she doesn't really like it. The lady, it's all just kind of in stride, which is dope.
She has a, I like her approach about it. It's just like I can do this, but I don't have to do this, you know? Exactly. I just want to be at peace. So I like her character a lot.
Me too.
And I liked her when I first saw her in the first episode. Mm-hmm. So I was like, well, I like her. Like, she seems so... See, I wish she was a little bit more sassier. Like, I really want these characters to really grab me and, like, really expand out of that. Because all of them really seem like chilled stoners, you know? That's what they're giving. And I really want them to kind of, like, give me a little more. But... You know, I guess it's skating.
I think it's simmering. I think they're doing the setup. Obviously, the first show was just establishment. These are the characters. This is what they're into. This is how they get down and deal with each other. And then the second episode was more delving into who they are specifically separately from the group and how that dynamic works with one another. And I think the farther we go down the road in terms of the episodes, you know, as the season goes on, I think that they will definitely highlight them individually again, but give more of a backstory and make them more intriguing and kind of jump out there. You're right. They are pretty chill. Okay. But what skaters, people that are attracted to that sport, do you know that are just like wild guys? There aren't really, when I think about, I mean, not that I know the history of all skating, but I think about like Sean King. This was the guy that used to wear his hair really long. He didn't skate. He snowboarded.
Yes. I think he had a game. I think there was a game named after him. I think I know you're talking about. Maybe. Oh, yeah, I'm not
definitely.
Really sure.
A game.
But there was a slogan. Oh,
yeah, he's a big deal. He's a big deal in that world. Like, he's won gold medals. He's made quite a name for himself. So I say all that to say that of that world, skating, snowboarding, like, it's all kind of interrelated. I only recall his name is the only one that stands out to me because.
What about Tony Hawk?
And I was about to say Tony Hawk is as chill as they come. Like, he's not that guy. Like, look at me, check me out, bright colors, whoop whoop dee. That's not his world. Like, he goes in, he kills it. Obviously, he's like the godfather of skating. He's the one that introduced the world to this element in terms of making it mainstream, making money from it, video games, merchandise. Showcases, competitions, all of that was him. But he's never been that guy that shows up with like a purple fedora talking about what's good. He just kind of slips in, does his thing, flips all around, wins the award, and just like, thanks for playing, going home with my wife and the kids. You know? I kind of get the impression that that's most skaters, is that they're pretty chill.
I think it's a good representation. I mean, I'm not a skater, but I would think that that's what they would be like, a skater. But it's also women, so it's a nice tie-in to it. Okay, so in the last topic, there's a bigger situation that happened. So we're introduced in this episode we know who Janay is, but Janay, they open up to her story about she has a YouTube channel.
Right.
And with this guy named Donald, right?
Yes, and so, I love their show.
That show was actually very interesting. Like, being a YouTuber myself, I was like, looking at it, I was like, oh, like, it just got to get it. I love the show. And the message behind it was actually entertaining to watch. Like, I want to go find it right now and watch it.
Exactly. That and the graphics, we're making the whole situation move. When you think about, when I think about the average YouTube show or podcast, it's very, you know, I sit here, you sit there. Camera possibly over here, definitely the mic's right here. We have a conversation. Mm-hmm. Maybe we laugh, throw our heads back, maybe we high five, but that's about as crazy as it gets. I love the interactive element of that with the graphics and the ground moving and what did you think about this? And what are you gonna do with that? And the green screen in the back and I thought
It was fun.
Very attractive. I was like, okay, I gotta get on my grind. This is me all day. Like, this is what I was love to tips. Do. Yeah, definitely taking notes.
I was taking tips. So them two, after we see their YouTube show, she's looking at the page, the video, and she sees that the comments are turned off. Well, later on, she's at the park, and she finds out from Honeybear that that apparently there has been some comments that have been coming through to the channel about Donald, which is why he turned the comments off.
But that also lied to her.
Yeah. He lied to her and told her that they were off because, what did he say they were off?
He said they were off because they're coming for you. Like, they're being rude, they're being disrespectful to you, and I didn't want that to hurt your feelings. And she was like, bruh, like, this is what I signed up for. It's fine. Like, let me read what's going on. But she let it rock. She let it rock because he kept insisting that he was trying to be Captain Save-A-Ho. So she was like, yeah, all right, whatever.
He seems like he's her like brother type.
I think that's her brother, yeah.
You think it's her blood brother? I think he's
not. I would be surprised. Well, they have a brother sister relationship.
She had a comment. She made a comment about, I think she was like, if you were my something real. I think that's what she said. I got to go back and see that part, but I can't recall if it was blood brother and sister.
Yeah, I don't think they have the same mom and dad.
Not,
you're right.
They have a very good chemistry. It's very brotherly. And when she confronted him about it at his basketball game,
right,
you know, it came out that that he's being accused of a Me Too moment.
Yes. You know, that, I mean, because it just made me wince because I didn't see it coming. I love that turn of events. I love when there's a storyline that you're just like, wait, what? Yeah. What just happened? Obviously, the thought process, because that's how he painted it and because he seemed so sincere, was that in fact he was telling truth. When Homegirl uncovered it, hello, technology, what you thought? You turned off comments, people take screenshots. We can still pass along this information. I thought that was so dope. That that they decided that this was going to be the thing they throw in there and kind of mollywop us all. Like, wait, what? And the way he handled it, I was mad that I felt for him. I'm not gonna front.
He should have, but see, he took a while to say it, but when he did say it, it was. But I don't know, like the story, it just seemed. I need more. We don't know.
First time seeing his character. Right, we don't know.
And
we don't know.
He's new to the show in terms of this episode. So I don't really know much about him other than his YouTube.
Right.
But what he did say that stood out to me, and you can chime in too, was that he said that they don't want to hear the truth. They just want to hear a story or something like that.
So, right, exactly. You know, people focus on the negative. They don't want to hear what really happened. I don't like that he took the narrative of victim. That's what happens quite a bit with people that are in a position of entitlement entitlement is what it really boils down to. And so I immediately got a little defensive, you know, my back stiffened a little bit, like, let me see where he goes with this. But the more he talked about it, I can't front. Like, I have friends that have been accused of Me Too. And because I know them for years and years, it's very hard to framework my brain to think that they're even capable of this thing, right? So the fact that he was willing to, he didn't own any of it. And it was just a weird dichotomy going on in my brain, like, oh, well, maybe he didn't do it. And he seemed so stressed about it. And oh my God, he's going to lose his job behind it. And, you know, I let myself go down that rabbit hole, not even knowing the character. And without realizing until I turned it off, like, wait a minute, he didn't one time say, maybe she misunderstood and that's my fault. Maybe I didn't communicate effectively. Maybe I thought that it was okay when in fact it was not. I should go talk to her. I should try to make amends. I should try to figure out.
Well, she's trying to. What's her name? Janay, she said, she was like, let's fix it. And then he's just
No, but Donald never took responsibility. Janay is doing her best just to save this guy because she loves him.
Correct.
I'm telling you about my friends. But not one time did he say, this is my bad. I got to figure this out. I need to talk to this girl and get it situated because clearly she thinks it's one thing. And I'm sitting here telling you from my point of view, it was a whole different thing in my mind. But instead of being like, she got me, instead of saying that, bruh, how about saying, hey, did I really hurt her? Like, how about addressing the issue from her point of view?
Yes.
And not being defensive and, oh, poor me. Oh my gosh, she's accusing me. I can lose my job. What's going to happen to me? While she over here, you know what I'm saying? PTSD. Because of me. I just love that they threw it in there. So we're going to get deeper. I can tell that there's lots of.
I think it's going to be like very layered with that. And I wanted to see who this girl is.
Oh, yeah.
I want to know more about him and just him and Janae's relationship. Because it's good to see. I was glad they finally brought in someone else that was not tied to the skating.
Gotcha.
You know, that was a good thing that I was like, good. Like, they're more people that exist outside of the skate park.
So it can be full circle. It can be well-rounded.
Exactly. And that is what I was happy to see. So I'm excited. Like, it's getting better. It's starting to really, like, grab me a little more. The characters, you know, I think it was discussed about, I'm not sure if this is in your news, but this is about the actress and actors, like who they were, where they were originally. Is that in your news?
Right. That is in my news. And thank you very much. Okay. Should I get into that right now?
Yes, we'll let you go ahead and take over.
Excellent. Well, take over. You know, I'll just share. So I got this interview from literally the magazine interview, which is one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. And that's why I chose it. And basically just kind of breaks down where these girls came from, like what their origin mm-hmm. and why they decided to be a part of this. So yeah, The Skate Kitchen is the original movie that was made. It's mm-hmm. a documentary style movie, and it's about a real life all-girl skate crew that inspired director Kristen Moiselle's beloved film back in 2018. So just as I suspected, these women or these girls were not actors that were cast in this film. It was more like, this is their real life. This is how they get mm-hmm. down. And we're going to put you, I mean, because it's a documentary, right? So you don't need actors for that purpose, but to then bring it into an HBO series. Is a pretty, not only is it a huge deal, but for them mm-hmm. to not recast and say, okay, we love the film, we love what you're going with it, but we want real actors to evoke emotion and to be able to, you know, have it resonate with the audience on a deeper level for whatever reasons. They didn't do that. They said, mm-hmm. you know, we believe in what they're bringing to the table. We believe in the storyline that they were able to provide. And so we'll stick with them. So again, I mean, I'm not watching it cringing, like looking at these girls going, oh my God, your acting is horrible. But it's pretty obvious that they're not actors. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't create a whole lot of jump off the screen at you. And that's probably why. But yeah, I do. There's a, you know, Rachel, Sarah, it just talks about how they met each other, how they came mm-hmm. into existence, how they were discovered to be a part of the whole movie, and then how that migrated into a whole different realm of entertainment doing the same kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, it explores it in a way that, and then of course it talks about the bumps and bruises that I don't think they expected initially. They were like, okay, ooh, you get on a board, you ride, and yeah, they get pretty beat up. And then obviously the harder
Go ahead.
I was just gonna say the harder things you try, obviously mm-hmm. the greater the chances are that you're gonna bust your ass. You know what I mean? If you're riding on like a little thin skin, like it's to be expected that you're going to come away with some bumps and bruises. So big ups to them for keep going back. You know what I mean? I broke my leg, but I'm still, as soon as I'm out of this cast, I'm back on those skates. That's a big deal. That's kind of dope.
That's very dope. And I, you know, before your news and before we discussed it, I didn't know. I was watching the episode and I was like, trying to figure out like I love to get into editing. And so I was looking at moments where it was the skater, you can see the lower half and it would go to the top half of the individual, trying to see, was it like a stunt dummy? But it really wasn't. So
no, it was them.
Like, okay, I was like, dang, these people, these actors, they had to learn how to skate, but now it makes so much sense.
Right, they are skaters.
And they were casted. So that makes everything so much easier and, you know, they love what they do. So of course, honestly, the bumps and bruises is like, I think that's like the glory of skating. You know, they love it. Yeah, you saw the first episode, Kurt was like, look at my, you know.
Yeah, it's a badge of honor, right? Like if you have no bumps or bruises after having been out there day after day, it's almost like the other skaters are probably side-eyeing you like, are you sure you really out here? Like, are you amongst us or are you just perpetrating fraud? You know, you're down like, with the cool kids.
Like our girl Indigo.
Exactly.
She hit a split.
She sure did, didn't she? She hit a split easy. Like, okay, this is cute. Because it was still when she thought it was cute, right? Till she busts her ass, you're going to be like, I already told y'all this was not my thing. So I'm probably going to have to walk away. But we'll see. I hope she doesn't. I love her.
Okay. Well, again, do you have any final thoughts? Do you have any final thoughts or predictions on how the rest of this will go? The show?
You know what? This is such a weird show. I really can't, no predictions jump out the top of my head, but if I had to think about where this might go, I think that Camille, if I had to guess, is going to cause even more problems. Like, I think the fact that she's not loyal, she clearly is chasing after this boy. I'm not going to jump out there and say she hot ass. I don't know that just yet, but she look a little fast. You know, all these girls are worried about skating and enjoying each other. And, because she at the boys'
house. She is a little more in hotter. I mean, and for one, I don't know if the other girls are lesbian, but I know that two of those girls
are lesbians. So,
they're not even making out with
each other. You know what I mean?
I'm sure Kurt, I know Kurt fought
a little bit. Oh, Kurt, she's ready. Right, she ready, no question. So that would be my prediction, is that Camille somehow creates yet another scenario that she comes out the victor, but the bad guy. I can see her stirring up even more trouble.
To piggyback off that, I think that she would stir more trouble, but I think she is going to realize that the grass is not greener on this male side that she's trying to be. And I think she'll have to somehow get back in with these girls who will be the only ones that will take her in at this point. Because obviously, with all these guys skating, they have the majority, and they also have the, can't think of the word right now, the, I can't think of the word, but they have the majority, and so they dominate. And so it's almost like if that one guy decides to write her off, the rest of the skate part.
Oh, yeah. I get that impression as well.
I feel like that's going to happen to her. She's really, really trying her best to fit in. And realistically, like, she's never going to fit in with that crew. Like, she is a woman, and that's just not going to happen for her, I don't think. And I think, honestly, you know, with Donald, I want to see this girl. Because this is a show, so I can honestly say that I believe that something happened with that girl. I think there's more to the story, and
I think he's misinterpreting what the story really boils down to. Clearly there's more that happened. He's being very limited in his details in an attempt to minimize his participation in it. I'm not throwing down no gavels. I'm not saying that man is innocent or guilty or any of that, but I do know that he did not take ownership. And that part is what bothers me, and that I'm side-eyeing the hell out of him and looking for this girl to hear her side, because that's a red flag right there. Not one time have you said, I don't know what I'm guilty of. I don't know what I don't know. Maybe I did hurt her. Maybe she did feel this. Clearly feel some type of way. So let me regroup and get my stuff together and then reapproach the subject more humbled, more grateful for the information, more... more asking for forgiveness. None of that happened. He was just like, man, you know, I could lose my job and I didn't even do anything. Like, the first thought is to be defensive. I'm not buying it, bro. I'm looking forward to that.
Okay. Well, if nothing else, you know, this was a great, 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 great review and after show. I guess we have to see what happens in episode 3.
I'm looking forward to it.
We gotta see what happens.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm Cortez. This is Kitty. Can you let everyone know where they can find you?
Oh, please find me on IG. Let's continue the conversation. I'm on Instagram at KittieKaboom, Kittie Kaboom, and on Twitter at Kitty Meow.
Okay. And I am Cortez. You can find me on IG as well at Stupid Wild Tez. We can talk about this show and any other show you want to talk about, because I love talking. So let's talk.
Excellent.
We want to thank everybody for joining us for AfterBuzz for Betty. Please stay safe and continue to support and watch these shows, because we have a lot to talk about, especially during the time where there's not much talking to one another. So without that, we will see you guys next week.
Thank you. Bye, guys. Bye.
Our founder, Keven Undergaro, and me, Maria Menounos, would like to thank you for tuning in to AfterBuzz TV. Remember, we're not just the first, we're the biggest in the world, and we're the only destination for all your favorite TV shows. Whatever you crave, we've got it. So go to AfterBuzzTV.com and check out our lineup. Buzz you later.